gives you a Harlan toy.
Good morning, Miss Phelps. The pictures you are looking at represent a small portion of an elite group. These people are now masquerading as full-fledged adults, when in fact we know they are nothing of the kind. They've infiltrated into society and may appear as perfectly ordinary human beings. The pictures you are looking at were taken some 20 years ago. Some of these individuals, as you will see, will be easy to identify. Others, however, have affected elaborate disguises that may be hard to single out. They have integrated themselves into every level of society. Housewives, doctors, teachers, social workers, contractors, businessmen and women. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, will be to find out what events and experiences occurred during the academic years of 1969 to 1971 in the lives of these people that have influenced them to become what they are today. As always, if any of your IMF forces are caught or killed, the Secretary will disavow any knowledge of your existence.
Coming up next on Eyewitness News, a special report on the 30-something syndrome. Are they really all grown up?
We'll look at fashion yesterday and today. What goes around comes around.
And later on, the big scoop on sports from the past.
And Mark Eubank has the weather all on Eyewitness News tonight.
Given. Many consider me an expert on natural foods like cattails. Yes, they're edible. I look for natural ingredients in my food. That's why grape nuts is part of my breakfast. This is a wholesome cereal made from wheat and barley. These natural ingredients are baked into crunchy nuggets and fortified with 8 essential vitamins. Its naturally sweet taste reminds me of wild hickory nuts. I call grape nuts my back-to-nature cereal.
Prominent researchers from the university revealed today their findings after a 20-year study of men and women who attended high school during the golden years of 1969-71. A representative sample of students from the well-known Highland High School in Salt Lake City was studied without their knowledge. The researchers found that those students have higher IQs, better integration into society, and fewer convicted felons than predicted, based upon their behavior and maturity level during high school.
What factors influence the course these people have chosen in their lives? Tonight we will present a special report detailing some of the important events that surrounded those golden years of 1969 to 1971. In 1969, the Vietnam War was still raging, and the draft lottery had been put into effect. However, little time was spent by high school sophomores contemplating the effects of war on U.S. society. On July 18, 1969, Senator Edward Kennedy plunged his car off a bridge on Chappaquiddick, killing his companion, Mary Jo Kopechne, and forever altering his life.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
July 20th, 1969 will go down as one of the most eventful days in history as U.S. astronaut Neil A. Armstrong, age 38, an especially productive time of life, became the first man to set foot on the moon. Do you remember where you were that day?
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
What would you do if I sang out of tune?
Who can forget 1969 as the year of Woodstock?
Lend me your ears and I'll sing you a song.
The first truly rock event, as thousands of peaceful participants proclaiming "Make Love, Not War," descended upon the small community of Woodstock, New York.
Well, I need it,
however, probably one of the most significant events of the 1969 school year occurred even before the school year actually began for the subjects of the study, when they attended a preschool rally in the tennis courts at Highland High. There they gathered to rock out to the sounds of the Deseret Mining Company and hear the welcome of student body president Mike Coulomb. That night they were told to enjoy living now in this, the time of your life. And thus began the journey of this select group of students, hereafter known as RAMs. The spring of 1969 was very busy for the young women who tried out for Pep Club. It was both a joyous and traumatic time for those girls involved.
And right now there are reports coming in that there is hail over Highland High.
How about a movie tonight, huh?
Wow, what's that aftershave you're wearing?
You high karate aftershave is so powerful, it drives women right out of their minds. That's why we have to put instructions on self-defense in every package. High karate, the brisk splash-on aftershave that smooths and soothes and cools. High karate, aftershave, cologne, and gift sets. High karate, be careful how you use it.
In 1970, millions of Americans participated in anti-pollution demonstrations. On April 22nd, to mark the first Earth Day, the attempt by Highlanders to clean up the earth, that is Sugar House Park, was aborted because of a spring snowstorm that year. Four students were killed on May 4th at Kent State University during a protest against the war. The spring of 1970 was filled with activity as numerous students tried out for various positions, including student body and class officers, ham and haw officers, cheerleaders, and staff members of the yearbook, Rambler, and Black and White magazine. In other startling news, Barb Ward stripped down to her long red underwear in a sordid attempt to gain the position of student body historian. Scott Jackson was heard to say at the time, "Golly gee." And Leapin' Larry Palmer put his foot down when Sterling Martell tried to put up the poster, "Vote for Sterling, he's a stud."
1971 started out in a rather grim way as Charles Manson, age 36, and three of his followers were convicted of first-degree murder in the 1969 slaying of actress Sharon Tate and six others. In the Vietnam War, the U.S. began a 44-day incursion into Laos starting February 8. A constitutional amendment lowering the voting age to 18 was approved in the Senate by a vote of 94-0. That was on March 23rd. And May 28, 1971, the senior class graduated in the 13th commencement exercises of Highland High School.
We'll remember all
coming up next, Keith McCord has the scoop on music of the golden years, so stay with us.
The years from 1969 to 1971 were years full of changes and transitions for the young people who attended high school during that time. The decade had begun with music which contained a certain innocence, a transformation from the simple lyrics of the Beach Boys and the early Beatles to the more complicated message rock had begun. Themes such as peace, love, and rebellion against the establishment began to emerge.
One, two, yeah. What is it good for?
Absolutely.
groups such as Simon and Garfunkel, Crosby, Stills and Nash, and The Fifth Dimension took over the spotlight. The poignant folk songs of Carole King, Carly Simon, and James Taylor drifted over the airways.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you've got a friend.
Crossover music such as Santana, The Guess Who, Creedence Clearwater Revival, and Three Dog Night also became part of the music scene. Some students at Highland High may remember the dismay they felt when told by Ursel Allred that they would be unable to attend a long-awaited Simon and Garfunkel concert because of play rehearsals for West Side Story. As a result of his cruel mandate, Ursel won the Lehman Lemon Award that week on KNAC. However, not all songs of those years were full of meaningful interpretations. Topping the chart for several weeks in 1971 was that insightful hit, Joy to the World by Three Dog Night. This rendition is dedicated to members of the class of 71.
Jeremiah was a bullfrog, was a good friend of mine. I never understood a single word he said, but I helped him a drink his wine. And he always had some mighty fine wine, singing joy.
The more cultured music of the time could be heard coming from the room of Mr. C, where Highland's a cappella and madrigals held their daily rehearsals. One only had to listen to the sound of Mr. Christensen as he instructed the students in the complex one ta-ta-ta, two ta-ta-ta, to know that professional caliber performances were taking place. Classic numbers such as Waters Ripple and Flow and She Walks in Beauty were a part of the repertoire, as well as more soul-stirring songs like The Big Rams Are Rambling and Keep Your Banners Floating High. Coming up next, cool phrases, cool cars, and cool fashions.
Every day there was something to get psyched over. Chicks were really tasty, and there might be a guy you really craved. Someone's idea could be far out, or it could be really hokey. It was a groove just being a Highland Ram. The whole experience was a real killer, and it would have been a bite not to be there. If you had the right car in high school, it could go a long way toward getting dates. A Fiat could be had for about $1,992, and a Barracuda went for about $2,588.
Check my custom machine. Rusted metal plate blue with the Corvette blue. Check my custom machine. And they say
engines were big, cars were fast, and gas mileage was something you just didn't worry about. Pollution control never discussed, and nobody wore a seatbelt. That would have made the drive to the H-Rock less than cozy. Carol?
Along with the car, the right look was something to strive for. The well-dressed Highland co-ed had specific requirements in the fashion department. Remember these must-haves? Mini skirts, pantsuits, knee socks, Lady Manhattan blouses, vests, weejuns, clogs, long scarves, and chains.
I remember I had a black skirt that hit me just about thigh high, and my dad told me that if I ever dropped anything, I should certainly leave it right where it lie. But I love that skirt. Obviously, others did too.
Are you going to wear it to the reunion?
Yes, I'll be wearing it on my right thigh this year.
Girls were not allowed to wear pants to school until the end of 1970, and only on Fridays. No Levi's could be worn, but Army-Navy pants were acceptable. However, casual weekend wear often included Levi's with frayed bottoms and long sweaters. Prom wear included long dresses, usually with empire waistlines. Who can forget the terrific hairstyles of the late 60s and early 70s? Hair was usually long and straight with grown-out bangs, parted down the middle and tucked behind the ears. Great pains were taken by the girls to get the style just right. Sleeping all night in curlers, sometimes the size of juice cans, or getting up at 5:30 a.m. to sit under the dryer was commonplace. For guys, the fashion uniform usually consisted of Levi's, an Oxford shirt or work shirt, and Wejins or rough-out cowboy boots. Yellow socks were also big at the time. If a guy was lucky enough to have a letter jacket, it was considered appropriate for almost any occasion. Lamb chop sideburns and straight hair parted to one side was the look to strive for. More yet to come, entertainment news, and Craig Bullerjack has sports.
Would you believe it's still hailing over Highland High?
Good evening. From the CBS News archives, I'm Walter Cronkite with a classic news break. 20 years ago this month, South Vietnamese troops, backed by massive American airstrikes, move into Laos. Meanwhile, Congress is told U.S. ground combat in Vietnam will end in midsummer. 1971's fashion rage is hot pants. While some designers say they're not for everyone, stores sell out quickly.
The late 60s and early 70s had their share of entertaining TV shows and movies. Some would stand up even today, but others would be classified as simply silly or stupid. In 1969 and 70, The Ed Sullivan Show was still a staple of the Sunday night viewing program. First telecast in 1948, the show continued until its last broadcast on June 6, 1971. Who could forget the hundreds of performances by groups and individuals of every kind?
They see hair down to there, say beware, and go off on a tear. I say no fair. A head that's bare is really nowhere. So be like a bear. Be fair with your hair. Show it you care. Wear it to there. Or to there. Or to there if you dare. My wife bought some hair at a fair to use as a spare. Did I care? Au contraire. Spare hair is fair. In fact, hair can be rare. Fred Astaire has no hair, nor does a chair, nor a chocolate éclair. And where is the hair on a pear? Nowhere, mon frere.
Warning. The program you are about to see is All in the Family. It seeks to
All in the Family changed the face of television comedy with its first broadcast on January 12, 1971. It brought a sense of harsh reality to comedy, which had previously been filled with inoffensive, homogenized characters.
Down. Every time you sit down on one of them things, the mystery's over.
Let me tell you something, Mr. Bunker.
No, let me tell you something, Mr. Stivic. You are a meathead.
What did you call me?
A meathead. Dead from the neck up. Meathead.
September 19th, 1970 was the first broadcast of the Mary Tyler Moore Show, which cast a woman in a more independent and realistic role. Mary Richards was the idealized single career woman and became a role model for young women who were breaking out of the traditional mold of the time.
Look, miss, I was just about to have a drink and I wouldn't mind some company. Want one?
Oh, no, thank you.
I said I wouldn't mind some company.
Well, all right, I'll have a Brandy Alexander.
Some coffee.
That'll be fine. Has the job been filled?
Yeah.
Oh,
But there is another job.
Oh?
I figured I'd hire a man for it.
Oh.
We can talk about it.
Well, good.
How old are you?
30.
No hedging. No, how old do I look?
Why hedge? How old do I look?
30.
The years from 1969 to 1971 gave us some memorable movies and performances, and for many Highland students, the place to see them was at the Camas Theater.
You know what you can do with them dishes. And if you ain't man enough to do it for yourself, I'd be happy to oblige.
Midnight Cowboy won Best Movie honors at the Oscars, although it was rated X and deemed not suitable for young people. Instead, high schoolers enjoyed such movies as Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid and True Grit.
Is that what you call giving cover? Is that what you call running?
Americans traditionally love to fight.
1970 saw Patton win the Academy Award for Best Picture, but movies such as Love Story and MASH were more interesting to teens. In 1971, action movies like Dirty Harry and Diamonds Are Forever appealed to all ages.
You've got to ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
That year, the Academy Award for Best Picture went to The French Connection, and its chase scene is a classic that still makes you hold your breath. On a more local level, great entertainment could be found right in the auditorium at Highland High. Each year, impressive productions were presented to students and guests alike. However, to the class of 71, the presence of the Fiddler on the Roof signaled a production which filled the stage with the unforgettable characters who inhabited the village of Anatevka. Craig will have a look at sports next, right after this.
If you think sports today are more exciting than the sports events of 20 years ago, then you've probably forgotten a great deal.
Namath on a handoff to Matt Snell. Snell at the five, Snell at the three, Snell touchdown!
1969 was the year of the Super Bowl, which starred quarterback Joe Namath. He led the Jets to a 16-7 victory over the Baltimore Colts. Now, the Mets took the World Series 4-1 over Baltimore, and in basketball, the Celtics, led by Bill Russell and John Havlicek, took the NBA title that year, beating the Lakers 4-2. On the local football scene, 1969 marked the final year at Highland for head coach Fickinger, as the Rams finished up a 5-5 record. Under the direction of coach Larry Maxwell, the Rams headed to the 4A state championship with a 9-3 season record. They entered the semifinals against Battleful High, but left with a disappointing loss of 70-89. The Highland soccer team, without the help of a head coach, went on to win the state championship that year, as well as the division championship held in Los Angeles. 1970 brought a win in the World Series of the Baltimore Orioles as they beat Cincinnati after a disappointing loss the year before. And in football, the Kansas City Chiefs took the win over the Minnesota Vikings to win Super Bowl IV. The 1970 academic year brought a new coach to Highland's football team. Hal Hardcastle became the man to show what he could do with the ball club. His first season as head coach of the Rams ended with a 4-6 record, but there were some games to remember. Two that stand out were the triumphant win over East, that final 19-8, after a 5-year losing streak, and the loss to West High due to a bad call and some bad luck. In 1970, Highland was again a contender in the state basketball tournament. After winning against Bonneville and Murray at the new Special Events Center, the Rams were pitted against the East High Leopards in the semifinal game. The game was close, moving back and forth between the two teams. However, with 55 seconds left on the clock, the luck went to East, and they walked away with the victory 63-59. What about girls in the area of sports? News specialist Jane Clayson has an update for us, Jane.
Well, Craig, you know, 20 years ago, young high school women had little opportunity to play competitive sports, especially team sports. Gymnastics and dance clubs were two areas in which they excelled, and their physical capabilities were accepted. Although girls were not allowed to participate in team sports, there was one area which they could not be overshadowed. Their enthusiasm and spirit in the stands helped to spur teams on to do just a little bit better. During the 1970 school year, a group of girls took over the job of cheering teams on to victory. They were called the Pep Club. In August of 1969, 80 girls began the first of numerous 6 a.m. practices in preparation for a year of marching, cheering, decorating, and basically having fun. Led by the serious Barbara Ward as president, they spent countless hours in fostering school support and many other hours just acting stupid. However, the officers did provide a great service when they unselfishly wrote Jean Bentley's wedding thank you notes for her. One thing that will always stand out in the minds of the Pep Club members, and probably others in the class of 1971 as well, was the size and skill of their drum corps. The sound of those drums as the 11 members rolled out the beginning cadences is not something that is easily forgotten. It's a sound that could still send chills up the spine. Back to you, Craig.
All right, thank you, Jane. 1971 saw the Baltimore Colts take the Super Bowl when they kicked a field goal in the last 5 seconds, winning that game 16-13. The Pittsburgh Pirates won the World Series after 7 games, beating the Orioles 4-3. And in 1971, the newly acquired Utah Stars won the ABA championship, giving Utah its first professional basketball title.
Now give a cheer and let's get on with it. Bring on the team.
At Highland High School, the class of 71 got to watch a football team that played hard and came away with a winning record of 6-3. By far the most exciting game that season was the one that still stands out clearly. The Rams had gone to play the Skyline Eagles on their turf and for their homecoming. In addition, the size of the Skyline team dampened the hope of a win for many. However, the afternoon served up some magic. Passes from Scott Jackson slipped in the hands of Paul Wortley. And Clayton Wyman. The Highland crowd went wild, and when it was all done, the score said it all. Highland 28, Skyline 27. The Rams basketball team finished with a winning season in 1971, 7-3. Again, they qualified to play in the state championships, and they played with heart and spirit. Although they did not take the title that year, Highland High has long had a tradition of being a worthy contender in the 4A state tournaments. That's it for sports. I'm Craig Bullerjack.
Our researchers found that the Highland experience was many things to many people. Just a few words, a few notes to a song can bring back the sights, the sounds, and the smells so reminiscent of that era.
And just a teacher's name can stir up memories thought long forgotten. Tonight we'll leave you with just a few thoughts to jog your memory. Goodbye, class of 71.
It was a very good year, and you look a lot better, believe me, than some of us who graduated 5 years later.
Saturday morning, I'm going away with my friend.
Tom Dow Invitational. That's it. Golf tournament.
Just I and my friend.
The good friends at Highland, as we see here tonight, will always be friends, no matter 20 years, 30 years down the road. Everybody's still a friend.
But we will remember long after Saturday's gone.
I remember playing for the Pep Club, and I was so pleased I went to the state championship, football championship, and they're still playing the very same drum cadences. I wanted to go down and join in.
Where does the time to do a dare run and go?
One of my favorite memories is before a football game, I had the great idea that everyone would take raw hamburger and eat it with our teeth and tell ourselves that we were animals. And that worked great until the second half and we got diarrhea and the coach from there let us do it after that.
I remember Janice Ashton looking at Gene Bentley and saying, "You are so strict. Is this the Army?"
I also remember very short Pep Club uniforms with petty pants underneath.
We didn't notice those as boys, of course. But...
Well.
Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind.
We remember the Camas Theater.
It was a lot of fun.
For the way we were.
We remember Mr. Kelly's great bow ties, especially on St. Patrick's Day.
Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? If we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we?
Harold Peterson. He was the best teacher I ever had, and I wish that he could teach me every day for the rest of my life.
Like the corners of my mind.
The thing I remember most is Faith Hacker teaching us, or teaching me, how to sew, and skills that I've needed now, which my mom never would have been able to teach me, and I appreciated her, and I wish I could still find her and tell her thanks, because that was a good thing to learn.
So it's the laughter we will remember whenever we remember the way we were, the way we were.
I walked in here and I saw everybody, and it really overtook me. I almost started to cry. I'm kind of embarrassed to admit it, but it's cool. See all these people, the time went by so fast.